everybody on Facebook Live. I'm Elysabeth Alfano, and this is another episode of Awesome Vegans. I'm live in Chicago on JaneUnChained with the internationally acclaimed, world-renowned violinist, vegan violinist, Rachel Barton Pine. Here she is. So I have a long list of her accomplishments. I'm going to read them. There's so many. While I read them, she's going to get ready to play so that Rachel can show you what she's all about.
Sounds good.
So you're going to see Rachel getting ready in the background. Prepare yourselves for this list. Okay. Rachel is very prolific. She's had at least 30 CDs. You just correct me if I'm wrong on any of this.
I think 37.
30, right. Who's counting? 37 CDs. She's played for the President of Singapore. She's played for Supreme Court justices. She's played in Israel and in Vienna and in Budapest and Chicago and LA and Calgary. She's played all around the world. She's garnered awards all around the world. And if this weren't enough, if she weren't a dedicated musician since the age of 3, which we'll get into, she also has a foundation that helps others become exposed and play classical music, and she's been a big proponent of female violinists. But we'll get into all that. First, I want to show you what she's all about. So I'm going to go ahead and turn the camera around, and we're going to do a little classical music. Rachel, can you tell me what you are going to be playing?
Okay, this is music from about 300 years ago. One of my favorite composers, Johann Sebastian Bach. It's his jig in E major.
For that. Come sit down with me and let's discuss all that you have done to become this accomplished at the violin and how long you've been vegan to give yourself that little extra bit of stamina. So I'm going to reposition the camera now as we sit back down to talk with, obviously, as you all saw, acclaimed violinist Rachel Barton Pine. So Rachel, give me a little bit of the background.
Yeah, well, first of all, thanks so much for having me on the show. This is really exciting, actually, because I've had a total of one food-related interview in my entire life, which was a print interview for Vegetarian Times magazine.
I love them.
And so this is actually my first vegan interview. Yay!
Wonderful! Wonderful! And I'm going to get all into how veganism gives you stamina and why it's important for you to play as a violinist and have your best healthy self with you. But let's start all the way at the beginning. I think you've been playing the violin since the age of 3.
Yes, absolutely. And you also asked about when I became vegan, and my parents converted in college, so they raised my sisters and me vegetarian. So I've never eaten a bite of meat in my entire life. And obviously what I do is very athletic, so clearly that's fine. I actually always disliked milk products, both the taste and the feel of them to my body. But I would eat eggs occasionally, mostly just on the road when I was touring around. And then when my daughter was born 7 years ago, I had to decide, did I care if her other grandparents gave her organic chicken or something? And I didn't really have a strong opinion because my parents' diet was more for human health reasons rather than animal welfare. And so not being a convert, I really had never thought about things. I liked the food I ate. I had no reason to ever eat differently, but I didn't care that my husband has a steak now and again. So I started reading about it, and it really became clear that, like, the gold standard of health is plants only. And so that's how we decided to bring up our daughter. And it's turned out to be wonderful because she is such an animal lover that she loves to hold cute little spiders and pet cute little snakes. And, you know, she doesn't want me to step on an ant as we're walking down the sidewalk. So she probably would have been one of those little children who, you know, announces to their parents that they only want to eat plants. And then the parents go, what are we going to do? But luckily we were already feeding her that stuff. So it worked out great.
And for anybody who has questions, because you've gotten ahead of my interview, this is perfect. She's well-versed in the subject. So what do you say to anybody that says, oh my gosh, how could you raise your daughter vegan? Do you get any flack for that?
Well, I think just seeing what I do, you know, up on stage and the intensity of the touring lifestyle and the, you know, kind of Olympic virtuosity that you have to have on the fiddle, you know, people think, well, I guess if you're able to do this on this diet, that it must work. But, you know, occasionally I'll get a fellow parent who says, you know, what about protein and so on. And, you know, and people are always fascinated to realize that you can get protein from algae and, of course, you know, your obvious legumes and nuts and seeds and soy, but also raw zucchini or, you know,
broccoli,
yeah,
kale.
Exactly. And, you know, goji berries are a complete protein. You know, and quinoa and all these different things. So really, and especially with traveling around, it's so much easier to stay healthy, actually, because, you know, you can just go and get some good stuff and not be tempted by all the fast food and all of that.
So do you do a lot of cooking then at home to make sure that you and your daughter are all set, or how does that work at home?
Oh my gosh, sometimes I think I should, like, have a blog or a, you know, some kind of video show about how to make healthy meals in your hotel room with nothing but a bathroom sink, a microwave, and a mini fridge.
I would follow that blog. Yes, I would.
But I'm too busy practicing to actually ever get around to it. But yeah, I actually fill a lot of my suitcase with supplies. You know, sort of the non-perishables, like Tasty Bite, you know, chickpea and lentil meals, because those are neither frozen nor canned, because cans add weight when you're trying to pack,
right,
you know, all your stuff. But the, you know, the sort of room temperature packages, also, oh, what's the name of the brand? Fig foods, bean soups, and beans as well.
Yes,
though, of course,
beans.
You can usually find canned beans at most grocery stores. But depending on, you know, my schedule and whether I'm going to even have time to go to the grocery store, fig foods is a great option because they're not canned and they're not refrigerated. And then I have, of course, the microwavable rice bowls, and I bring a lot of nuts and everything like that. The one thing I do acquire on the road is, you know, fresh produce in terms of fruits and vegetables. But if I'm doing a trip with a short flight, sometimes I'll even bring a cooler bag and bring a whole bunch of fruits and vegetables with me. Again, if I'm, you know, hitting the ground running, going right into rehearsals and interviews and school visits and concerts, and I don't have time to get to the store. So yeah, it takes a bit of planning, but it's totally worth it. And I like not having to scrounge, you know, to go and find restaurants and all of that.
I just want to repeat for someone who asked, so this is Rachel Barton Pine, the world-renowned acclaimed violinist. I'll say also that when I'm traveling, I'm like the only person who goes through security and they're like, is that an eggplant? Wait a minute, are those like asparagus? What's happening here?
I've had customs agents in other countries go, what are you planning to do with these seeds? Are you going to, you know, violate our agricultural laws by planting them? And I'm like, no, I'm going to sprout them. And then they see my weird nut bars and they believe me.
I love that. And Sylvie, your daughter, who's going to join us later and she's going to play with us, does she have any favorites? Mommy, make me this. Mommy, this is my favorite plant dish.
Yeah, well, I've raised her, as my parents did with me, completely without sugar, without artificial colors, artificial flavors,
great,
you know, any chemicals at all. And so we'll be at, you know, one of our numerous post-concert receptions, and people will offer her a cookie, and she'll very politely say, no, thank you, do you have any fruit? Because she actually prefers fruit. You know, I'm trying to raise her generally without refined grains. You know, so yeah, it works out great. She's never had a piece of candy in her life and doesn't desire any because fruit is so yummy and there's so many different kinds. But actually her very favorite meal is falafel and dill rice from our favorite Persian restaurant.
That is my favorite meal, actually. I could
so
eat
shout
that
out to
every
Reza's. Yes.
Okay, and you live practically across the street from Reza's, right?
Well, until they closed that.
Oh,
that,
no.
Now we have to order it from Rogers Park, but whatever.
Oh, so right by me. Yes, shout out to Reza's. Yeah, I could have that meal every day of my life. I love that meal, and I never tire of it.
For me, it's Indian food.
Oh, really? So you like it spicy?
Very spicy. Well, I think it's the red hair.
Okay.
Actually, the biggest difference between my husband and me is not that he'll eat meat and I don't. It's the fact that he likes everything plain and bland, and I like everything full of flavors and hot and spicy and all of that.
So that's a tricky kitchen when one person is bland and one person is super spicy. But I think even trickier, and I have this situation with my own boyfriend, so your husband eats meat.
Yeah, but, you know, he doesn't ever have it in the house or cook it in the house because on the few days a week, you know, 1 to 3 days per 7 that we're home, he's generally at his office catching up with everybody, you know, because he travels with me the other days of the week. So he'll just order in and, you know, or eat vegan food, you know, pasta, peanut butter sandwiches, whatever. And then we're on the road, of course, he orders room service or things like that. So it really actually, and we can sit down and have family meals. He'll have his scrambled eggs and steamed broccoli, and I'll have my whatever it is, in more interesting concoctions.
So that's fascinating that he lives with the two of you, you and your daughter, and he hasn't been convinced to go. Not that you are trying to convince him, but it hasn't sort of naturally worked out for him to be plant-based.
No, I mean, he eats super healthy. Mm-hmm. Like, he eats whole grains, no chemicals, the whole thing, but his tastes are very limited, so you know, there are only certain veggies that he likes, and only certain preparations that he likes, and I think there wouldn't be enough things for him to eat he only ate plants, so, you know, so I'm definitely not judgmental. Everybody's physiology is different, but I do love the fact that by eating plants, I'm doing, you know, the most I can for the environment, and that's, you know, super, super important. Like, you can do all the recycling, but by just not eating animals, you're doing so much more. And I like that happy side effect.
Yes, me as well. And I love that you get that. So many people don't put that together. And the UN climate change report just came out, and the media was very slow, if at all, to pick up on the fact that animal agriculture is really the main thrust behind the climate change. Of course, there are things like transportation, but animal agriculture, if you include
by far,
if you include deforestation as well as all the gases that are emitted from the animals, you're talking about at least, I think it's 45%, and that's like much more, I think almost double than planes, trains, cars, automobiles, everything together. So if you don't take a dent into animal agriculture, you really don't affect climate change.
Well, that was actually, you know, one of my motivations behind raising my daughter this way is that I have so many friends who want to go plant-based, but they're just, you know, kind of culturally and taste bud addicted to their favorite foods, which they've eaten their whole life. You know, they can't be without cheese, they can't be without bacon, and I empathize with that. And so I thought, you know, why don't I just not ever leave my daughter with that dilemma where she wants to stop eating this food and can't. If she's ever eaten it in the first place, it simply won't be an issue.
I love that you say that because, and I'll shout out to not just, you know, meat and dairy, but also sugar. These are drugs in a way, and refined sugar, I think, is so addictive, and a lot of people feel addicted to cheese, and they say that there are addictive components in cheese. And so I think it's wonderful that you haven't set your daughter up for dilemma or failure. You've just not put it on her plate. Now she likes the natural sweetness of fruits, and the dilemma just doesn't present itself.
Yeah, it was
wonderful.
Hilarious. When she was really little, like 2, 3 years old, and we'd be at a restaurant, and she would have her little plate with hummus and crudités, I would have strangers like coming up to me all meal long going, "Oh my gosh, I can't believe your daughter's eating that healthy stuff." And Sylvia was like, "Hummus and veggies is really yummy. What, like, why is that weird?"
Yes, right. And so she must set an example for other kids. Do they ever either poke fun, or are they curious of the food that she eats?
Probably neither. They just go and eat their cookies and kind of don't pay attention to the fact that she asks for whatever alternative.
Because Sylvia's 7, is that right?
He just turned 7.
Turned 7. So we're going to have Sylvia play for us in a little while, and we're going to have Rachel play for us again as well. But I do want to hit on
music.
Yes.
Yeah. Sorry, I'm just what so you excited are. To talk. This is like my first ever interview where I've gotten to talk about
being vegan.
Yeah.
So I have interviewed Rachel before on WGN Radio and then also on my television show in Chicago, The Dinner Party. And I remember how you were vegan then. This is before I knew about veganism and before I had become vegan. And you were saying how yummy your choices are. And it's great to see you're just as passionate as ever about being vegan and about the violin. So tell me, how did you come to know about the violin at the age of 3?
Yeah, I saw some girls playing violin in my church when I was 3, and they were middle school age, and I just loved the sound of the instrument.
Oh, wow.
And their beautiful long dresses were certainly intriguing. So I asked my parents for lessons, and neither of them had grown up playing an instrument, so they didn't take me seriously at first, but luckily there was a teacher in the neighborhood, and walking distance, we started lessons, and I just fell in love with it. And it's been, my obsession ever since.
Well, that's amazing to me because usually most of us struggle our whole lives on knowing where we can make an impact, on what we really want to do, what our true purpose is in life. And you found that it, like, you had a love at the age of 3 and you knew your purpose by, like, the age of 7.
Well, 5, really. When I made my debut
late
with orchestra.
Bloomer.
But, yeah, when I was 5, I really started self-identifying as a violinist and signing my kindergarten papers, Rachel, violinist. And my parents were like, I thought this was a hobby, not a profession. What's going on here? And, I didn't have any idea about careers, but I just knew that this was my calling and that moving people with music, uplifting their spirits, was the thing I enjoyed most and the thing that I was good at and could do to help the world. And I just felt like this is what I was meant to be. And my mom, of course, looked into it and saw that you could earn a living, and so she let me keep on pursuing it, thankfully. And it's I'm so lucky that I get to do what I love and it pays the rent and I get to have so many fun adventures.
Is it fair to say that you were a child prodigy? Because you were performing well under the age of 10.
Yeah, well, I definitely would have to admit that I fell within that category. But, I want to say for all the parents out there, it really doesn't matter how old you are when you first do something. I use the example of, like, the babies who, one crawls at age 6 months and the other doesn't crawl till age 9 months, and the second parents are, like, getting really stressed and the first parents are overly pleased with themselves. But yet, it might be the late crawler who becomes the Olympic sprinter, because what you do in childhood doesn't necessarily correlate to what you become as a grown-up. And so, a kid who plays a piece at age 10 might kind of fizzle out or lose interest, and a kid who doesn't play that piece till age 15 keeps progressing and becomes a great artist. So what really matters is, do you have something to say on stage when you're 20, 30, 40, 50, 60 years old? I was lucky to attain a high degree of skill level early on in my childhood. I hate that word prodigy because you sound like a performing monkey. And I always wanted to be good, not just good for my age. But in any case, I was lucky to get good sooner than usual because I got to have fun sooner than usual, and that was what it was all about.
So I want to talk a little bit about that because I think that's very interesting. So I took piano lessons, probably everybody out there took some kind of musical lesson when they were a kid, but you talk about finding your voice and having something to say. And for me, as much as I loved playing piano and I found it very relaxing and I still like to do it to this day, I don't have anything to say with the piano. It is clear that I am playing someone else's music, and I'm doing the best I can there. But you talk about having a voice in playing your violin. Talk to me about that.
Well, actually, pedagogy has evolved a lot, where obviously a large part of what we do, almost exclusively sometimes, is in classical music, is playing either recent and or historic compositions by others. But nonetheless, improvising can be so educational, and freeing and inspire your imagination. So I always advise every student, to just play around with writing their own melodies or adding decorations to the melodies that they're studying, or just, experimenting with different dynamics, different articulations, not just what's on the page. Even if, certain composers, you do have to be strict and honest and, be like, you're not going to change the words in Shakespeare. But exploring that creative side enables you to then bring a more personal sense to how it is that you're playing the notes. And so, I've had the opportunity to play heavy metal on the violin, to do some fiddling and different things like that, and of course Baroque period improvisation, and all of that I think has actually made me a better artist when I'm up on stage playing the Brahms Violin Concerto.
So this to me is fascinating. It's not just that she loves to play classical music on the violin, but you really see yourself as a violinist, and if that means you're going to play goth punk rock on the violin, is that fair to say that you do that too?
Mostly metal, but
metal
and some classic rock.
Okay, so,
but actually my latest album, Blues Dialogues, is a whole collection of music by 20th and 21st century black composers, classical art music inspired by the blues, which of course is my indigenous hometown music that I grew up with, the Chicago blues. So I'm really excited about that because it's kind of like got a non-classical twist, but it's pure classical music at the same time, so it's like this wonderful fusion.
Oh, that's awesome. So this is very unfair, because I told her that she could play whatever she wants, but I don't know if the piece that you're going to play
Oh,
that's what you're planning to play?
Of
okay,
course.
So before we break for more performance, just one quick word about how do you find your creative spirit? Is there anything you do to get yourself in the mood or to warm yourself up for improv? Where do you find your creative juice?
Well, I think, you know, the most important thing about playing music, you know, you think about the sports-like side of it with all the fast-flying fingers, and, you know, that is definitely an element, but that's a means to an end, not the end itself, as it would be if I were an Olympic athlete. You know, all of what we're, and of course there's the intellectual side, which I love, reading about music history, the life and times of the composer, and, you know, how the violin was played back then, whatever century and country it might have been. But really, the most important thing is the emotions of the music, telling a story without words and communicating those emotions to the audience so that they also get caught up in all of the feelings that you and the composer are creating together. And so when I'm preparing for a performance, the majority of what I do is trying to figure out exactly what nuance, what shade of emotion is happening, in my opinion, and how I feel about it, because everybody's personality is different, but exactly what I want to do emotionally with every moment of every piece, and then trying to do, put myself into that fully when I'm on stage.
Well, let's not talk about it. Let's see it. Mm-hmm. Would you mind playing us another piece?
Absolutely. So this is called Louisiana Blues Strut by a composer who ended his life in Chicago, Coleridge Taylor Perkinson. I was very honored to know him at the end of his life and work on his music with him. And it's just an incredibly fun piece, as you will see.
Okay, I'm going to let Rachel set up. So again, it is internationally acclaimed, world-renowned violinist Rachel Barton Pine. She's going to play a contemporary piece for us here live on Jane Unchained. I'm going to turn my camera around so that I can get Rachel performing for us. I can't tell you just how lucky we are, everybody. Most people pay $100, if not more, to go to the Art Institute, or the Chicago Symphony Orchestra, or Berlin, or Calgary, who knows, to see Rachel, but we've got her here today.
Thank you.
Oh my gosh. Rachel Barton Pine, I wish I could clap, but I can't because I'm holding the camera. Thank you, Rachel Barton Pine. She's going to sit down with me again, but I think it is obvious. This is very physical, what she does, and it's very athletic. And no wonder she needs a great plant-based diet, because there's just so much involved in what you do and the stamina. I mean, we just saw 2 minutes, but imagine you're playing 60 minutes like that. Or if you're at a concert.
2 hours.
Or 2 hours. Yes, if you're at a concert playing that much. It's just incredible. I have a couple more questions for you before we let you do a duet with your daughter, which is just so wonderful. Let me ask you, so some of the questions that I like to ask at the end of the interview, and some of them are like off the cuff and just like one word answers, but some of them are more involved. So do you have a favorite snack?
Ooh, gosh, do I have a favorite snack? I don't know if I have a favorite.
That was not meant to be a stumper.
Okay. You know, it's just like different. What I have with me, what's in the fridge, I guess I don't.
So you're very easygoing about your snacks.
Yeah, pretty much.
Okay. Do you have any pets? And if so, do you think they're any different than farm animals?
Ooh, farmed animals, right?
Yes, exactly right. You guys heard that. She corrected me and said farmed animals.
Mm-hmm. Well, actually, because I'm on the road so much, yes, we can't have a mammal, because I'm gone, you know, like 4 to 6 days a week, and you know, sometimes in the summer for weeks on end. So, and I grew up with multiple cats, and my daughter is desperate to own a cat, but it just wouldn't be practical. So that's, you know, one of the downsides to the touring lifestyle, but I get to be in a different city or country every week, so I can't complain. My daughter keeps saying, well, can we get a reptile? Can we get a yes, fish? But actually, she's not so into the fish, because she realizes that that's kind of like, you know, solitary confinement in those tiny little tanks compared to the open ocean. Even though they, of course, are protected from getting eaten, it's not necessarily a good trade-off for them.
Yes.
But she wishes she could have a pet, but
nothing right now. No, but do you think they're any different than farmed animals?
Pets, absolutely. And I think it's actually, you know, people get all upset when people in certain countries eat dogs, for example, but I think that's actually more intellectually honest, because, or, you know, because if you're, like, why pick one species over another? Like, you know, pigs and cows are sweet beasts also, and why are you going to eat them and then, like, treat your dog as your child? Like, to me, that just doesn't make sense, actually.
And they have even more community than dogs, and they're even more focused, pigs in particular, on raising their young, and cows as well. So
pigs are so smart and
so
loving.
Smart, yes. And of course, the cruelty that goes on in the dairy industry when you're ripping apart baby from mother is just an unspeakable thing that people don't often think about.
People think being vegetarian is kind, but you aren't thinking about, and I especially thought about this so much when I was a nursing mother. Like, oh my gosh, what if somebody just took away my baby? And how can you eat cheese and stuff like that? That was all those hormones making me think of it. But I think, you know, and I'm totally not judging anyone, but, you know, I think vegetarianism is maybe a little bit of a trap, because it's not necessarily healthy to eat all that dairy.
You might
be better off eating some fish and you know, but really better off to just skip the dairy.
Yes, better off to skip the dairy. So many people see improvements in their skin, in their digestive system. So many people have cow's milk protein allergy and or...
get calcium from kale.
Yes, of course, get your calcium from kale. Or they have intolerance to lactose, so many reasons to skip dairy. And of course, cruelty would be one of them as well.
Actually, one of the interesting things that I've been seeing more and more is as veganism is becoming more widespread, there are starting to be more and more unhealthy products. You know, all of these like...
The junk food vegan.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, and you know, vegan marshmallows and vegan licorice and like, you know, these soy, processed soy, I don't even know what it is, that's pretending to be chicken and all of these things. And I'm like, well, just give me some tofu. I don't want all those chemicals
right.
and stuff
yes.
like that.
Yes, or give me a big bowl. That's my favorite. So I go into the fridge and I say, okay, what's about to go bad? And I put them together so I have a high tolerance. You know, some people like don't like their food to touch and they don't want this to
oh,
touch
no,
that.
I love
that's not me.
Concoctions.
No, I like to put things together. And I just want to go in the fridge, make sure that whatever is about to go bad, I put it on quinoa or rice or whatever, and I mix that, even if it's sweet with savory or salty, I put it all together, and a bowl on the run, that's my go-to meal.
Awesome.
So let me ask you, what do you wish you knew 10 years ago that you know now?
Well, gosh, that's a really good question. I mean, I guess the arc of an artist's life, of an instrumentalist, is, you know, so different from that of an athlete, where, you know, I would be definitely in my decline by now if I played most sports. But as an artist, you can aspire to be better at age 50 than you were at 40, better yet at 60, at 70. Eventually, of course, you become decrepit, but hopefully not till you're in your 80s. And so, you know, I feel like, yes, I know things now that I didn't know 10 years ago, but that's what I expected, and I'm really excited to find out what I'm going to know 10 years from now, and so it's nothing that I regret, because how could I have known it until I had lived those years and had those experiences?
Is that for your whole life, or are you speaking specifically about music and what you continue to learn in the musical realm?
Well, most of my life is music.
Okay, so. Fair enough. Yes, fair enough. Okay, is there one phrase that you live by? So if you're in a tricky situation, or you're running late, or just you're having a down day, is there anything that you say to yourself? I'll give you an example. I like to say, nose to the grindstone, eyes to the sky. I also like to tell myself, a body in motion stays in motion. These are things I tell myself to kind of get through when I'm in a tricky time. Do you have anything like this?
I guess not in terms of like a pithy saying, but I,
fair enough.
You know, I just, you know, sometimes remind myself of, you know, my purpose in life, you know, and just that playing music is what I'm supposed to do for others, for the art. It's definitely very tied in with my religious faith, you know, feeling like this is a gift from God and that I'm helping do God's work in the world by, you know, sharing my music with others and supporting young artists and things like that. And generally, you know, I enjoy what I'm doing so much that, well, I mean, I don't enjoy maybe packing the suitcase and answering emails, but still, that's a means to an end. And what I do, I enjoy so much that I rarely need to motivate myself beyond just being excited to do what I do.
I love that. And I'll just add to that, I am not religious at all, but I do agree that if we all just utilize the talents that we have, God-given talents that we have, if we all focused on doing that, right away the world would be a better place. So I
Absolutely.
Love that you're committed to your special talent and taking that as far and as wide to as many as you possibly can. My last question for you before we get a little duet back on here, live on Jane Unchained. Before we see the future in action, your daughter, do you have any predictions about the future? And I'll leave that really wide open. That could be 10 years from now, that could be tomorrow, that could be about veganism and plant-based, that could be about music, or that could just be about anything.
Well, I'm definitely an optimistic person. I mean, I think realistically, we all realize that climate change might go awry and or somebody might push the button when they shouldn't, and, you know, maybe our planet won't exist 30 years from now or some dire thing. But nonetheless, I like to think that, you know, what is that saying? The arc of history bends towards justice. And, you know, thinking about the fact that, you know, we did abolish slavery even though there are still problems. We, you know, we now have marriage equality even though there are still concerns about, you know, those laws being diluted. But, you know, like, things do seem to be getting better in terms of social progress. And so, you know, there is a child in my daughter's violin class who's in the process of transitioning gender, and there's so much support for this child and so much acceptance. And, you know, it's little things like that that give me so much hope that, you know, we're becoming kinder and more compassionate and more aware. And there's lots and lots of work yet to be done, but, you know, we all have to do our part. And I'm hopeful and optimistic.
I actually am as well. And I see lots of little changes all the time. People come up to me and they say, oh, you know, I see your interviews on Jane Unchained, the awesome vegan interviews. And I think, oh, I'm going to give up meat at least, you know, half the time, half the week, or, you know, I've been eating more and more vegetables, or I've found this because of this show, and I see lots of little incremental differences that tell me that people are aware and starting to think consciously about their actions here on this planet.
But you know what I think isn't going to change is having great classical music in our lives.
Ah, wonderful.
Because, you know, people will say, oh, audiences are aging, audiences are shrinking, classical music is dying, but you know what? They were saying that 25 years ago, 50 years ago, 60 years ago. I mean, you know, yet here we still are. And there's so many exciting things happening with young people being ever more entrepreneurial and creative. And, you know, classical music is evolving, but it serves an important role in our lives. And I think it's always going to be there, which is a nice sense of purpose and you know, happiness, I think, to imagine that whatever else happens in our world, we'll still have our great symphonies and our great chamber music and be able to make music for each other and with each other.
I do say, even though I have no musical talent whatsoever, music is the one thing I could never live without. So I am so grateful to you for bringing it to people. And I've seen you perform so many times. And as you guys get to do right now, we're going to bring Sylvie, her daughter, up, and Rachel. They're going to perform together. But I just want to thank you for all you do, your optimism, what you do for veganism, what you do to bring music to everybody. Just thank you for your general presence in the world.
Oh, well, that's very sweet. You're welcome. Let me intro this piece. This is from the curriculum that my foundation is publishing this week, Music by Black Composers, Violin Volume 1. We're publishing that along with a coloring book of the 40 most important black composers from all around the world from the last four centuries, men and women, and also a timeline poster showing more than 300 black composers throughout history. This is a piece that Sylvia really likes. It's by the earliest known black woman composer from mid-1800s Brazil, Chahinha Gonzaga. She wrote more than 2,000 pieces and was the first woman to conduct an orchestra in Brazil. And Sylvia actually got to play it for some Brazilian children when we were down in Brazil last month. And it's just a really beautiful piece.
While you two set up, come on, Sylvia, come on, camera, come on, let's squeeze in here, come right on in. This is Sylvia, everybody. She's going to belly up to the cameras. Hi. So I know you guys are going to set up, and thank you for playing. Hey, do you have a favorite snack since your mom didn't have one? Do you have a favorite snack?
Nah, maybe cantaloupe.
Cantaloupe, okay. That shows you this vegan kid's got it going on. I want to ask you, how can people see you perform, Rachel, and where should they go to get more information?
Yeah, well, my website has you know, all the links to my socials and my tour dates and also my YouTube channel. I have a podcast called Violin Adventures. I've not added episodes since this one was born, but it has more than 70 previous episodes about all kinds of different stuff. But, you know, hopefully I'll be in a town near you sometime soon. And I always love meeting the public after my shows. And if anybody's vegan, be sure to tell me.
Okay, so rachelbartonpine.com, that's the website. You guys set up. You're going to play this duet. It's about a minute and a half, so we're going to get a mother-daughter duet here. And I'm going to move the camera once again. Wave, Sylvie, wave. I'm going to move the camera once again so that I can film them do this piece together. And I just want to remind everybody, you can go to rachelbartonpine.com, and you can find out Rachel's tour schedule. And so that you can see her perform live.
Just getting the violin. I can do it for you, hon.
So while they're getting ready, let me ask you, Rachel, if it's not too confusing for you, what is your next city that you're playing?
Oh, I'm going to be in Kentucky. I can't remember the name of the city. Because I know I'm flying into Louisville and then I'm driving to the other city and I cannot for the life of me remember what it's called. Because the orchestra is not the name of the city. It's called Orchestra Kentucky.
Okay.
Anyway, then I go to the Columbus Symphony in Ohio and then I'm off to Reno and Princeton and Ann Arbor, New York, France.
So you're in the U.S. for a while.
Yeah, okay. I am. Till December.
They're getting ready to pull out Sylvie's violin as well. Oh, this is Sylvie's violin.
Sylvia.
Okay. Sylvia, I'm so sorry.
Sylvie.
Okay. Sylvie,
And this is Minerva.
Oh, tell us about your violin. Here, can I ask you to go just a tad bit over there? So sorry, Rachel. Just a perfect, you two. So tell me about your violin.
So when I got this old violin, I thought she must be very wise since she's so old. Mom
you remember how old she
is?
Yeah, she was made around the year 1700.
Oh, this violin?
Yeah, and this one was made in 1742.
Oh, my word. I understand that a patron has given you these violins for life. Is that right?
My violin is on lifetime loan, and Sylvia's violin we bought for her.
Wonderful. So,
and, of course, it'll be in my foundation after she outgrows it.
Yes, fantastic. Tell us again what you're going to play, and then we'll listen to you both.
Oh, yeah, I never said the name of the song. You want to do it, Sylvia?
Ballada. It's by Chiquinha Gonzaga from Brazil. The song was composed in 1884.
Wonderful.
Stand just a little bit. Here, I don't want to stab you with my bow. There we go. Thank you.
Barton Pine, please take a bow. Wonderful. Sylvia Barton Pine.
Actually, it's Sylvia Michelle Pine.
Oh, thank you for the correction. Sylvia Michelle Pine. Rachel Barton Pine, thank you both for being vegan. And thank you for playing classical music for us today and for being here live with me, Elysabeth Alfano, on Jane Unchained. Anybody who wants more information, go to rachelbartonpine.com. If you can, see this woman perform in person. It's outstanding. And if you're lucky, she'll have Sylvia Michelle with her. So hats off to you both. Thank you so much. Until I see you again, everybody, don't forget to be vegan.
Bye.
Bye.